share a few words today as we gather as powerful women at this ultimate women's power lunch. With many divisive opinions that plague our society today, I find hope in that today in this room, we are unified. We stand together in solidarity, proclaiming what is right for our cities, our state, and our country. We stand together to fight for equality, equity, and fairness for women and minorities, and only by working together can we end discrimination in all forms against all people. Standing for the rights of women is woven into the fabric of my DNA. My great-grandmother was a professional golfer and founded the Chicago Women's Golf Club in 1937. She petitioned the Cook County Board of Commissioners for privileges to play at the Pipe O'Peace Golf Course. After many appeals, permission was granted, and in 1952 became the official home of the Chicago Women's Golf Club that still exists today. Today, I find it my duty to heed her example in advocating for what is right and women's equality, and may I add, equal pay is what is right. I'm proud to join the ranks of other women who are first in an array of fields and disciplines, women like the Honorable Stacey Abrams, whose quest to become the first female African-American woman governor in the state of Georgia. That makes her a trailblazer and one that I am honored to be in the company of. And there is the Honorable Mayor Carmen, Yulín, Cruz of Puerto Rico, who is still fighting for basic human needs for the people of Puerto Rico, our fellow Americans. There are many others, far too many to name, but the importance in each of their stories is in my great-grandmother's story, is in my story, and in your story. To make change, we must stand up, even if that means standing alone. And when we see other women stand up, we must stand together with them. The power is within us. This room is full of courageous women who have beat the odds and continue to shatter glass ceilings and floors. Let us continue the good fight so our daughters and granddaughters and nieces and sister friends will have equality and enjoy the unalienable rights of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. I want to thank Congresswoman Jan Schakowsky for being a ferocious fighter, leader, representative in our nation's capital, and for her being a beacon of light, illustrating the ultimate power within women. Thank you so much, and enjoy the luncheon today.
Somebody told me that works, so yeah, it does. Welcome, welcome to the house that Jan built. I am honored to stand here as a co-chair and see old friends, new friends, and my beautiful family. It is awesome to look out and see over 1,600 people who hold one overarching belief expressed by Martin Luther King from Birmingham Jail in 1963. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. We have a moral imperative to be the change that must happen. Jan has been relentless in her quest for preserving choice, marriage equality, and comprehensive immigration reform from the floor of the House of Representatives for 20 years. She has been arrested, confronted, provoked, antagonized. She has fought for civil rights, human rights, voting rights, women's issues, health care, consumer protection, and equal access to high-quality public education. And still, hashtag, she persisted. And hashtag, she persists. What can we do? How do we follow the path of our extraordinary warrior, Jan Schakowsky? We speak up, we resist, we persist, and we show up. We vote, we organize, we get people little by little out of their comfort zone to join the blue wave. We make the phone calls to our legislators, we support Democratic women, candidates, Democratic men in every state. We run for school boards, we attend town halls. In our hearts, our minds, our words, we emblazon the vision that appears on the introductory page of the Indivisible Guide. If a small minority in the Tea Party could stop President Obama, then we, the majority, can stop a petty tyrant named Trump. So, repeat after me. I'm a fan of Jan. I'm a fan of Jan. I am a fan of Jan. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Okay, thank you. Good afternoon. Yes. Ladies and gents, thank you for being here to support the motherlode power source, Congresswoman Jan Schakowsky. She's the best. Now, can I just say that I have one of the greatest jobs in the world? I'm not referring to being controller. That happens to be one of the hardest jobs in the world. You know, the one where I'm responsible for paying the state's bills with no money to pay them. But all kidding aside, I get to introduce Jan Schakowsky today. And so for today, at least in this moment, this is the greatest job in the world. Now, before I do that, let me pay my respect to two other awesome women. The mayor of San Juan, Puerto Rico, Carmen Yulín Cruz. What a dynamo. And if you don't know how much of a badass this woman is, just ask Donald Trump. When she's not serving and protecting the people of San Juan as mayor, she moonlights as a geographer tutor to terrible presidents with oversized egos. Thanks to Mayor Cruz, Trump finally knows that Puerto Rico is an island, you know, completely surrounded by water, and that it's a U.S. territory and not part of Mexico. Muchas gracias, alcaldesa. Usted es lo máximo. And get ready to meet your next favorite politician, besides Jan, of course. That's Stacey Abrams. Yep. Woo! Oh my gosh, I have the mic. I can go woo! Yes. You guys are all in for a very massive treat here with Stacey. She's my friend. She's brilliant. I love and I admire her. And believe me, she is going to be the next governor of Georgia. We will all then be able to help make history with her, turn her into America's first woman African-American governor in the history of our country. It's time, ladies. It's been far too long. Now is the time. Now back to our woman of the hour, Congresswoman Jan Schakowsky. Jan served 8 years in the legislature and is in her 10th term as our Congresswoman. And I say our Congresswoman because regardless of where you live, Jan is a fighter for us. She's been a fighter for the middle class. She's championed the rights of immigrants and is always welcome at our dinner table and in our pantries. Now, did you know that Jan led the campaign to put expiration dates on food labels? Well, she's put one on President Trump, too. 2020, I don't know, maybe sooner, folks. Jan has been a staunch ally of the LGBTQ community, as well as a fierce, fierce champion and leader in the fight for health care for all. She fights for our right as women to have dominion of our own bodies. And yes, that means get your hands off of our uteruses. And oh my God, I just realized that I'm being literal when I say that Jan Schakowsky needs to tell the President of the United States of America to keep his hands off of our, well, you know. So in the midst of the Me Too movement and in Trump's America, Jan's voice is more important and necessary than ever. Jan inspires little and big girls of all ages. One look around this room and you know what I'm talking about. And in fact, I'm one of them. I'm not afraid to take risks and I never ever back down from a necessary fight, no matter who the foe, because I have had Jan Schakowsky serving as my role model for the entirety of my career. She is one badass resistor and persister. Jan, your spirit and your fight have led the way. Thank you for setting and owning the stage. Let's give it up for our champion resistor, persister, and our sister, Congresswoman Jan Schakowsky.
Thank you. I want to tell you, my beloved sisters and very secure and exceedingly intelligent brothers that are here. So welcome to our 17th Ultimate Women's Power Lunch. You are a sight for sore eyes. I'm telling you, you lift my spirit, and I promise you that this launch is going to lift your spirits too. I want to thank my co-chairs. I'm so grateful to them, Donna Miller. I'm so proud of her for winning her election to become the next commissioner of the Cook County Board. I want to thank Donna Gottman. You know, we are really sisters for a very long time, veterans in battles for women's rights and human rights and justice for all. And then, of course, our fearless and effective state controller, Susana Mendoza. So I just have to tell you one thing about Susana. I absolutely fell in love with Susana when she described her style as a politician as something you almost never hear. She said, "I am not risk averse." Is that beautiful? I mean, how many politicians do you see kind of skirting around, trimming, dodging, and Susana, and you've seen her take on Bruce Rauner, the governor. So we thank you. So I am, as always, going to introduce all the elected officials here. And in order to get through that, you know how we do it. Our tradition here is one clap. Let's hear it. That's it. One enthusiastic clap. Now stick with me because there's a lot of them, but I want to do that because it's really important to thank and recognize people that have put themselves out there, that stand up and run for office. So we're going to start with our Illinois state officials. We can do one more clap for Comptroller Susana Mendoza. For Mike Ferrix, our Illinois treasurer. Cook County elected officials include the president of the Cook County Board, Tony Preckwinkle. Cook County State's Attorneys, Kim Fox. Cook County Clerk, David Orr. One more thing about David, we want to thank him. Let's give him real applause for all his years of service. Thank you, David. Cook County Commissioner Bridget Gaynor. Former Assessor of Cook County, Jim Houlihan. Future Assessor of Cook County, Fritz Kagi. Okay, all right, hold on. From the City of Chicago, we have the City Clerk, Anna Valencia. For the Chicago Alderman, James Kappelman. Chicago Alderman, Sue Sedlowski-Garza. Chicago Alderman, Joe Moore. Former Chicago Alderman Helen Schiller, my friend. Chicago Alderman Michael Scott. Chicago Alderman Deborah Silverstein. Illinois State Senators. I just want to say the legislature's in session, so I'm going to introduce some former state senators, but they're all down there, and then I'll have a message from Heather Staines in a minute. So I want to welcome former state senator Susan Garrett, Bill Maravitz, Carol Ronan. Okay. Now we've got Illinois state representatives, again, former because they're in session. Kim Dubuclé, Lauren Beth Gash, Mike Curran, Julie Hamos, Ricka Sloan, Monica Faye Stewart. Okay. And now, from the Metropolitan Water Reclamation District, we have the Chair, Marianna Spiropoulos, Josina Morita, Deborah Shore, and Carrie Steele.
Put it down.
Oh, and you couldn't hear me? Okay. All right. So, local officials, and I just want to say, local races are very, very important. So, the mayor of Highland Park, Nancy Rotering. Evanston Alderman, Ann Rainey. Former Evanston Alderman, Eleanor Lavelle. We have Evanston Alderman, Robin Ruth Simmons. Former Alderman, Mark Tendem. Former Evanston Alderman, Dolores Holmes. Evanston Alderman, Melissa Wynn. Former Park Ridge Alderman, Rex Parker. Northfield Trustee, Shiva. Okay, I'm going to try and get this, Shiva. Moshe Zada. I don't know. Okay. I'm sorry, Shiva. I love you. Okay. Northfield Trustee, Jane Goldberg. North Aurora Trustee, Mark Gate. Let's see, Lincolnwood Trustee, Jesus Patel. No, Jaisal Patel. One more clap, okay. Okay, former Niles Township, not Niles Trustee, Luella Preston. Oakwood Hills Trustee, Kristen Zahorak. Elliot Hartstein, former Buffalo Grove mayor, and Will County Board, Jackie Trenier. Okay, and then we've got Kevin, I'll get it, Camare Kuhn from the Skokie Park District, Mary Mahady, McHenry Township Assessor. Okay, Neota Figs, Calumet City Clerk. Aurora Estriaco from School District 207. Candace Chow, District School Board 65. Missy Fleming, former 202 School Board. Okay, judges, here we go, honorables. Carol Bellows, Helene Berger, Susan Coleman, Carolyn Gallagher, Megan Goldish, Judy Goody, Deborah Gubin, Shelvin Marie Hall, Robert Harris, Patricia Holmes, Nathaniel Howe, Nate Howe, Sharon Johnson, Bertina Lambert, Mark Lopez, Pam Loza, Martha Mills, Leonard Murphy, Leonard Murray, Rita Novak, Jesse Outlaw, Kathleen Pantley, Marion Perkins, Abby Romanek, Naomi Schuster, Deborah Seaton, Sanjay Taylor, Mary True, Rena Van Tine, Debbie Walker, Jeannie Wren. Okay, now we have Democratic Party officials. Who did I miss? I'm sorry, for the Metropolitan Water Reclamation District, Commissioner Barbara McGowan. Okay, Democratic Party officials. We have Doug House from the Illinois Democratic County Chairs Association. Stephanie Coleman, 16th Ward Committeeman. Dean Maragos, New Chair Township Committeeman. Lucy Moog, 43rd Ward Committeewoman. Robert Murphy, 39th Ward Committeeman. Bob Piker, DuPage County Chair of the Democrats. Bob Reamer, former 48th Ward Committeeman. Nancy Shepherdson, 6th District Central Committee. All right, ambassadors. Faye Hartog-Levin, former ambassador to the Netherlands. And Andy Shapiro, former ambassador, these are under Obama, to the Czech Republic. We have some out-of-state officials. I'm so happy that my colleague Charlie Crist from the U.S. Congress from Florida is here. Kathleen Sebelius, former Secretary of Health and Human Services and former Governor of Kansas. Dr. Andy McGuire, she's a candidate for Iowa Governor. Laura Kelly, Kansas State Senator and candidate for Kansas Governor. And L. Priscilla Hall, former New York Supreme Court. We have Mary. Oh, I think I forgot Mary True. You know, we back to judges. We have Mary True, Rena Van Tine, Deborah Walker, Jean. Oh, I did that. Sorry. Okay. I'm still getting notes, though. Don't let me forget you. You came all this way. I want to announce you. Okay. I also want to give a shout out to our Democratic challenger, to Bruce Rauner for governor. I am so proud that J.B. Pritzker is here. We're going to win. Okay. I just want to say this. I am very excited that we're going to have a progressive governor that's for a progressive income tax, that's for early childhood education, that's for a public option for health care, yes! Bunch of thank yous. I want to thank my staff, Sarah Gerson and Jackie Tewitt for the Finance Committee. Ben Head, my political director, all the congressional staff, Tom Greenhaw for doing the slideshow and the in memoriam, and all the volunteers. Thank you, volunteers. I want to wish Betty Cerf Hill a happy birthday. Now listen to this, folks. I want to recognize, I don't know where she's sitting, my dear friend and inspirational activist who will celebrate her 100th birthday in August, Bea Lumpkin. Bea Lumpkin, where are you, Bea? There she is, over there, Bea. All right. I'm telling you, Bea to more events than I do and you do. I'm telling you, it's unbelievable. I want to give a shout out to my friend, I'm so proud of her, Jill Winebanks, who is the former Watergate prosecutor and now an analyst for clarifying just how guilty Donald Trump may be. Okay. I want to, two extra thank yous for people who aren't here. I am so grateful to the best attorney general in the country, Lisa Madigan, who is not going to be running again. We're all, and our children, are all safer and better off because of her. I also want to thank State Representative and Majority Leader of the House of Representatives, Barbara Flynn Curry, 40 years in the Illinois House of Representatives. I want to thank all the workers at this hotel, Unite Here, Local One. Thank you, everybody. We appreciate you. I want to thank our photographer, Dean LaPrairie, who's here. Thank you, Dean. Smile pretty for Dean. You see him coming. So here's a final message I wanted to give from State Senator Heather Staines. The Equal Rights Amendment, remember that? Equal Rights Amendment, yeah. Passed the Illinois Senate on April 11th with a bipartisan vote of 43-12, including 8 Republicans. Okay. Heather has an assignment. She wants us to call our state representatives. Illinois, if it passes the House, would be the 37th state to ratify the Equal Rights Amendment. Only one more state is needed to cement equal rights into the Constitution. Okay. About time. So many of you have asked me which candidates to support. And over the next several months, I'm going to be letting you know. Trust me, we know who you are. We have your email. We know how to reach you. We're going to be letting you know who some of the very best candidates around the country are. Today, you're going to hear briefly from four Illinoisans and, from three Illinoisans, but I'll tell you about one, and two that we must get elected from other states. And we're making it easy with the form that is on your table. There is one more form that lists the names and how to contact the, candidates that you're gonna hear about today. So we hope that you will help them. You know, we're gonna have to get involved in campaigns all over the country. Okay, now, I want all of my colleagues, the incumbents that are here today, to come up and stand behind me, come up real fast. Here's the stairs, oh good. Somebody got them ready, I love it. So, here today, we have Sherry Bustos from the 17th, Bill Foster from the 11th, Brad Schneider from the 10th, Charlie Chris from Florida. I want you to know that Mike Quigley was here earlier, but Mike Quigley. You stayed. Oh, I'm so happy. Oh, good. Okay. So because we have a lot to do, and because this is good practice for the House of Representatives that begins every day with 1 minute, where any member can get up and speak about anything for 1 minute. So we are giving 1 minute to our candidates that are here. Let's start, we are gonna start with, from running against Rodney Davis, in the 13th district is Betsy Dirksen-Londrigan. Come on up, Betsy.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Betsy Dirksen-Londrigan. I'm running in the Illinois 13th district. I'm born and raised in Springfield, Illinois, hometown of Abraham Lincoln, Senator Dick Durbin, and most importantly for today, Congresswoman Sherry Bustos. And I decided to get into this race when I saw my congressman celebrating on the White House lawn with Donald Trump. And I don't know if you remember that, on May 4th of last year. It looked like a frat party on the White House lawn. And they were celebrating taking health care away from millions of Americans. I knew I had to get in this race because my husband and I have raised three children in Springfield. And in the summer of 2009, we almost lost our oldest child, Jack, to, of all things, a tick bite. After 21 days in the pediatric intensive care unit of our local children's hospital, we were very fortunate that we were able to take our boy home. I know what it feels like to be terrified in the hospital and terrified all over again when those bills start coming. So to see people celebrating taking that away, no way. I'm in this race because I believe that health care is a right and not a privilege.
We have only superstars here. I want you to meet an incredible young woman who is running in the 14th district against Randy Holcomb, Lauren Underwood.
Good afternoon. Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Lauren Underwood. I'm running for Congress in the Illinois 14th congressional district. Thank you, ma'am, for having me. I'm a registered nurse from Naperville and decided to step in and run for Congress after our Congressman Randy Holcomb had his one and only public event of 2017. It was a question and answer session where he made a promise that he was only going to support a version of Obamacare repeal, which allowed people like me with pre-existing conditions to keep our health care coverage. And as a nurse, I know how critical it is. Critical for people to have access to medications and procedures when they need it. And then he went and turned his back on us and voted for the American Health Care Act, which is a version of repeal that did the opposite. And I was disgusted, I was frustrated, and I said, you know what, it's on. I'm running. And so launched the campaign. Thank you. And won with 57% of the vote in a field of seven. So delighted to be here, and with all of your support, we're gonna win in November. Thank you.
And now, someone who is running against Peter Roskam, right, that you may remember not only voted to repeal Obamacare every single time, but is the author of the tax bill that I shouldn't give your speech, Sean. I don't know what you're saying. Anyway, okay, he just makes me crazy. Anyway, our candidate, welcome Sean Kasten.
Jim, thank you so much. Thank you all. I'm Sean Kasten, running to be a representative in the 6th District. I'm a biochemist, clean energy entrepreneur. Woke up angry like all of you did after the last election because I think that facts matter, and it makes me violently angry when people deny climate change. I want to thank, there is this amazing blue wave that all of us candidates are surfing on, and you guys are the energy that's driven that through good times and in bad, but the fact that we're winning coal country in western Pennsylvania, Virginia up and down the ballot, and we're going to bring a respect for decency back to Washington, respect for women and for working families. We're going to bring back universal health care with your help. We're going to recognize climate change is real. And I cannot tell you how excited I am to be the representative of Henry Hyde's old district with the hope that we can repeal the Hyde Amendment. You've got my vote. So thank you. Let's put a gavel back in Jan's hand.
I wanted to just mention one other candidate from the state of Illinois who couldn't be here today, who is absolutely awesome. He is from downstate, even more downstate than Sherry. It's way down south, and that is Brendan Kelly, who is an awesome candidate, running against Mike Bost.
And we absolutely expect that he can be a winner, so I hope that that you will help. Now, I wanted to introduce you to a couple of our what we call our red to blue candidates who come from other states that really can use your help. I am so proud, and I've known her now from the last cycle, to bring to the stage State Representative and our next Congresswoman from Michigan 7th District, Gretchen Driscoll.
Thank you all. It's great to be back here, actually, because we're going to beat them this time. As Congresswoman Schakowsky mentioned, I did run in 2016. I was a state representative, and I'm a former mayor in a community in the district that I will be representing next year. And it's such an honor to be here with all of you and also our congresspeople here from Illinois. Thank you. You know, in Michigan, we had a little problem in 2016. And I just want you to know we're back, and we're going to be blue this fall. It's happening. There's a lot of activism, a lot of engagement. I know I've talked to some of you. We're really, really excited about what's happening in Michigan. In my district, we already know we had our first poll, and our poll shows us pulling ahead of the incumbent when we get our message out on affordable health care, like was talked about, good-paying jobs. We're still struggling. My district's along the Ohio border, so automotive was a big impact. And finally, making sure we invest in our community. So I have a lot of small towns in the southern portion of the state, but we know we can win based on our polling. So I really appreciate the opportunity to be here and speak with all of you and just let you know, Michigan will be blue, and we're going to be back at it. So thank you so much.
Blue Michigan sounds fantastic. I just love this, our next speaker, and you're going to love him too, from the state of New Jersey, the 3rd Congressional District. And thanks for coming all the way here, Andy Kim.
Thank you, everybody, for having me here. My name is Andy Kim. I'm running in the New Jersey 3rd Congressional District. This is the district that gave my family the American dream. I'm the son of an immigrant. My father grew up in an orphanage, survivor of polio, homeless his child. My mother grew up in a poor farm family in South Korea after the Korean War. But in South Jersey, they were able to get jobs. My dad was able to become a PhD in genetics, dedicated his life to trying to cure cancer. My mother, a nurse. This is the district that gave me... This is the district that gave me the public school education that allowed me to become a Truman Scholar, a Rhodes Scholar, a PhD in international relations. And I dedicated my career to giving back to this country. I've served as a U.S. diplomat, an advisor to General Petraeus out in Afghanistan, a Middle East advisor to President Obama at the White House. Now standing up and fighting back in my district, helping flip a district that President Obama won twice, running against the author of the Trump health care bill, somebody who went to the University of Chicago and worked for the Chicago Coalition for the Homeless. And I'm very honored to be here with you. I'll be back in June. I hope to see many of you at a fundraiser we're doing. We'll be in touch. Thank you so much.
We were very much hoping that Iowa State Representative Abby Finkenauer would be able to be here today, too. She's a current state representative, and when she gets elected to Congress, she will be the youngest woman in Congress, 28 years old, and she's fabulous. So remember that name, Abby Finkenauer. Meantime, let's just give a great round of applause for all of our representatives and future representatives. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. I missed a couple people. I wanted to mention, get your claps ready. Tracy Katz Mull, Northfield Township Committee Woman. And then I didn't do my own committeeman from my hometown, Eamon Kelly, Evanston Democratic Committeeman. Latasha Thomas, who is the committeeman and former alderman. So let's say thanks to her. Okay. Okay. Now, looking at my list here. So
I wanted to begin my remarks with a big thank you. Were it not for you, it would be easy to despair about the state of our nation. When people ask me, and they ask me all the time, how can you stand it? I tell them about you, about people who are standing up and fighting back against this daily attack on our democratic values. The resistance is unprecedented. I've been an organizer, well, for going on 50 years, whatever, and I have never seen anything like this. It's bigger in numbers than the civil rights movement, bigger than the anti-Vietnam War protests, and bigger than the Tea Party ever was or hoped to be. Okay, here's the audience participation part. So when I say, how do you feel today? You answer so everyone in this hotel can hear you, powerful. So how do you feel today? Yes, beautiful. This is without a doubt unsettling times. And for many, it's really terrifying times. Tweet by tweet by tweet, Donald Trump is working to redefine our country in ways that make it almost unrecognizable to us and to millions of people all over the world. It's especially traumatic now for immigrant families. Raise your hand if you were not born in the United States of America. Let's keep them up. Raise your hand if your parents were not born in the United States of America. Put them up if you're grandparents were not born in the United States of America. Okay, I want you to look around this room. This is who we are. This is what America looks like. Few of us are very far from the immigrant experience, and each family and each wave refreshes our democracy with new vigor and makes us all better. And I am not going to waste your time enumerating the worst of Donald Trump. That would be fun, but no, I'm had it. Okay. You already know it's a horror show that we're living every single day. We need to focus on beating him and all his enablers. That's our job. So I want to talk about how we win, how we are winning, and in the streets and at the ballot box. I want you to leave here today feeling as powerful as you sounded just a minute ago and with a personal plan for what your role will be for victory. So the mandate is clear. I'm gonna say it two more times. We have to win, we have to win. And here in Chicago, you know, the 2018 Women's March was even bigger than last year. Yeah. You know, so much for the pundits who thought we would get tired and we would just go home. And the march this year was strategically called, and I appreciate it, Women March to the Poll. And we have already witnessed remarkable electoral victories in places like Virginia in the House of Delegates, where a diverse group of 13 Democrats, many running for the very first time, beat 13 Republicans, all white men, no offense, white men, okay, but all white men. And one is Ashley Bennett, a 32-year-old African-American woman who decided to run when her delegate mocked the 2017 Women's March on Facebook, writing, quote, "Will the women's protest end in time for them to cook dinner?" He's gone. Yeah. Right. Or Danica Rome, who became the first transgender lawmaker when she beat the man who bragged about authoring the discriminatory bathroom bill. He's gone. Alabama now calls Democrat Doug Jones senator. Yeah. And last week, Connor Lamb of Pennsylvania was sworn into the House from a district that Trump won by 20 points. So we Democrats have recruited candidates to run against every single Republican that's running in the House of Representatives again, except for three or four, and we are not done recruiting. And so far, 46 Republican House members have opted not to run, and they're not done retreating. So we are on a good roll. And how about the teenagers from Parkland, Florida? Amazing, amazing. I think the NRA has finally met its match. And it's not just Parkland, Florida. They sparked a national movement of high school students who are both focused and fierce. And their message to politicians, their fearless message to politicians is, if you're not with us, we're not with you. And here today are two organizers of the Chicago March for Our Lives, Marley Rosario and Alex Swerdlow. Where are you guys? We honor you. We honor you. Okay. Thank you. Okay. Awesome. Oh, they're over there. Okay. Awesome. Awesome. We thank you. Okay. More good news. I'm just about good news today. That's it. The Washington Post and the Kaiser Family Foundation conducted a big poll in January and February and reported that an unprecedented number, 1 in 5 Americans, have protested in the streets or participated in political rallies since the beginning of 2016. And of those, here's even better, almost 20% said they had never done that before. How many of you are in that category? Okay, new people, we welcome that. You can proudly raise your hand. Yeah. And overwhelmingly, these activists do not like Donald Trump. 30% approve of our president, but 70% don't. And about one-third say they intend to volunteer or work for a 2018 congressional candidate. How many of you are ready to do that? Come on, yes. We need to. Another recent poll found that 66% of Democrats have high interest in the 2018 elections compared to 49% of the Republicans. That is the exact same percentages in reverse from 2010 when we lost the House. So we are positioned because of this enthusiasm gap. Another important part of good news, one piece of good news, one group of voters that always shows up are people over 65 years old. And we have been losing seniors for decades. And, well, I should say we lose white seniors. Thank you, thank goodness, especially for older African-American women who actually come to the polls. Ask Doug Jones about that, and he'll tell you. Yeah. So this last election, we did better than usual, but still won only 45% of the plus 65 vote. But now, older, white, educated voters who helped elect Donald Trump are trending toward Democrats, according to a recent Reuters-Ipsos poll that says, quote, in such numbers that their ballots could tip the scales in tight congressional races from New Jersey to California, unquote. Yeah, seniors, they get it. And it's no wonder that they get it, because Paul Ryan, in his retirement announcement, laid out the one thing that he still hopes to get done before he leaves, and that is cutting Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid. And my view is, Paul Ryan, make my day. Make my day. I think it's going to be real hard to find even one Republican that wants to see their health care cost more and their Social Security check less. More and more Americans have come to realize that it's up to us, that no one else is going to bail us out of this one. So if you want suggestions on the best use of your time, my political director, Ben Head, is among us, and we're ready to work. Ben and I and all of our staff and everywhere people organizing are ready to put you to work. And if you think I can personally be helpful to you or your group and come and talk, I am happy to do that. I'm the national chair of candidate services for the Democratic Congressional Campaign Committee. And we are fielding 106 candidates. You've met some of them as our superstars today. In order to be in the majority, we need to win 23 seats. We're fielding 106 candidates, and we need 23 seats. History is on our side, and in part, thanks to Donald Trump, the enthusiasm is on our side. He has awakened a sleeping giant. If each of us pledges just to put one foot in front of the other every day, that's what Nancy Pelosi always says, just one good day after another. If we register voters, knock on doors, host a coffee or a fundraiser, contact all our friends on social media, write a check, write a letter to the editor, show up at marches and events, talk to your neighbors, we will win. And when we do, my brothers and sisters, Donald Trump will be remembered not for threatening our democracy and not for his stunning lack of decency or for his racism and his sexism and homophobia and Islamophobia, and not for tarnishing the name and stature of our beloved country around the world. Donald Trump will be remembered as the president who awakened that sleeping giant that ushered in the most progressive era in the history of the United States of America. Say amen. Amen. I believe that. And you helped me believe that. So, now the people you've really been waiting for. And so I'm going to introduce Stacey Abrams, but I want you to know that while precious few women have been elected governor in our country, in the history of our country, 39 women to be exact, 39 women ever been governor, including Kathleen Sebelius, from Kansas, Not a single African-American woman has ever been a governor in the 241-year history of our country. Well, we are about to hear from a woman who will end that sorry statistic. Stacey Abrams is poised to be the governor of the Peach State of Georgia. And I want you to watch a video. This is Samantha Bee video. Listen to this power woman, and then let's all help to make history with Stacey Abrams.
Welcome back to the show. 2018 is an election year, so we interviewed a very inspiring black woman who's running for office. No, I said actually running for office. Ashley Nicole Black has more.
After the Democrats' stunning win in Alabama, one thing was clear. Black women bailed out white people again.
This was a miracle.
Well, it's a miracle to Becky. For black women, it's called a Tuesday. Black women have always been the door-knocking, get-out-the-vote secret backbone of the Democratic Party. No more political side chicks.
You want me? Earn me!
Democrats, you can't just have black women save your ass. Elect a few.
We have the power to declare that black lives matter and to defend dreamers without having someone question our patriotism.
Oh, look, here's one. This is Georgia gubernatorial candidate and hashtag style goals, Stacey Abrams. The state's House Minority Leader since 2010, she could be this country's first female African-American governor ever. But at only 44, she's 44.
The next governor of Georgia, Stacey Abrams.
Thank you.
all too nice to me, I might not go back to Georgia. I first want to say thank you to Congresswoman Jan Schakowsky for her generosity in inviting me, for her leadership across this country, and for being, and I will use the most precise language that I learned at Yale Law School, such a badass. Thank you so much. So I grew up in Mississippi, which we like to refer to as South Chicago. And my parents are both from Hattiesburg, Mississippi. My dad likes to say he was from the wrong side of the tracks, and my mom is from the wrong side of the wrong side of the tracks. My mom is one of seven children, and she is the only one of her seven siblings to ever finish high school. But she went on to graduate as valedictorian of her high school, went to college, went to graduate school, got a master's degree in library science. I only get 10 minutes, y'all gotta hold on. My father is an amazing man, but my dad is dyslexic. So imagine growing up a young black man in Mississippi who can't read. Too many people who met him just told him he was stupid. But he knew that he had this amazing capacity to memorize anything he heard, which often his older sisters pointed out because he told all their business to the wrong people. And my father memorized his way through school, becoming the first man in his family to go to college. Now you can clap, they're both good. But I talk about my parents because my parents, that story is the beginning of the American dream. My parents went to college together. They met in high school. My mom was tutoring my dad. He said that she was the most brilliant and beautiful woman he'd ever met. He says he wooed her. She says he stalked her. We don't really talk about it too much. But they went off to college together. He went with my mom when she got her master's degree. They moved back to Mississippi, ready to live the American dream, only they were still black and my mom was still a woman. And so my mother found herself as the college librarian at a college where sometimes the janitor made more money than she did. My father, despite being a brilliant man who got a BA in history from one of Mississippi's top colleges, couldn't get a job in an office, and he became a shipyard worker, which is noble work, but he didn't have a choice. So my parents had this option. They could have sunk into the depression that comes along when you realize that your capacity is not met by the courage of your community. They could have said it's too late and too little and given up, but my parents decided they weren't going to be bitter, they were going to be better. And so they raised their six children with three jobs: go to church, go to school, and take care of each other. They told us to go to church because they wanted us to be grounded in a faith that was larger than ourselves. They wanted us to be grounded in an ethic, a moral framework. But the faith I was raised to believe has been distorted by too many people. Because I don't believe in a faith that would discriminate against people because of who they love and who they are. And my faith is not the faith. And my faith does not say who God allows us to worship. My faith defends other faiths. It does not strike them down. Because our faith is a shield and never a sword. But my parents said our second job was to go to school because even though education hadn't gotten them beyond working class poverty, it had gotten them further than most people they'd ever met. And so they told us you were gonna go to school every day, and if we missed a day of school, you need to have a surgical scar and a doctor's note. Because what they knew, the secret that they knew, was that education is transformative. And they told us you can lose your job, you can lose your house, they can take your car, but no one can take what's in your mind. And they made certain all six of us finished high school and all six of us went to college. And that is why I am proud to be the only public education advocate running for governor in the state of Georgia. You see, I have a Democratic opponent who is calling herself a public education person, but she voted for vouchers, and she has supported keeping those vouchers, and she voted to auction off our public schools, and she's running as a Democrat. Well, I'm running to be the real Democrat in this race, and that is why I'm going to win. But the education my parents raised us to believe was also an education that begins at birth. From cradle to career, we take care of our children. That's why I'm proud to have introduced legislation and to be working for legislation when I become governor that will provide for early learning, for child care, and will help parents take care of their kids.
from cradle to career. Go to church, go to school, and take care of each other. That third job seemed to perplex us a little bit when we were little because we didn't realize, we'd ask my parents, when they would wake us up to go out to volunteer, we would point out to them, you guys do know we're poor too. But my dad, his way of telling us to go was, look, having nothing is not an excuse for doing nothing. And so they would wake us up on Saturdays and take us to soup kitchens and homeless shelters, to juvenile justice facilities, to nursing homes, because my mom would say, no matter how little we have, there is someone with less. Your job is to serve that person. And that service is why I'm running for office. That service is why I'm here. That service is why when I become the next governor of the great state of Georgia, my first act of business is going to be the expansion of Medicaid in the state of Georgia. That service is why I'm going to continue to pursue criminal justice reform, because you should not be jailed for poverty in the state of Georgia. But that service is also why I'm going to be the governor who ensures for the first time in Georgia's history that you can't be fired from your job because you are homosexual, because you are a member of the LGBTQ community. Because in the state of Georgia, civil rights are civil rights for all when I'm the next governor of the state of Georgia. Go to church, go to school, take care of each other. That's what my parents raised me to believe. That is how I have lived my life. But I'm running for an office where some folks don't think I belong. I don't look quite like everyone else. But my belief is that I can get this done, because there's a path to victory in Georgia, because we are not a red state, despite all you've heard. We're blue, we're just a little confused. We're confused because I'm up against an old machine that has a playbook they've been using year after year after year, where you pretend to be progressive in the primary till you can make your way over to be a conservative in the general. The way I put it, we spend too much time trying to convince atheists to become Catholics. My job is to get Baptists to go to church. That is how we win. And in this primary, I have an opponent who has been outraised by me, outpolled by me, but unfortunately, she has more money than me, because I'm not a millionaire running for office, with all due respect to Governor Pritzker. But here's the thing. I could get past her issues if she actually stood on the right side of the issues. But my opponent wrote herself a check for $1.25 million because she got a B rating from the NRA and cannot claim to be the gun safety advocate in this race. Because my opponent has voted on the wrong side of history too many times to try to rewrite history. But I need your help because I know how to win. As minority leader, I flipped 6 Republican seats in the state of Georgia before the wave. And those 6 seats that we flipped are representative of what we can do across the state of Georgia. We lose elections in Georgia's Democrats by 250,000 votes. But in 2018, there are 1.5 million eligible registered Democrats who simply haven't heard from a Democrat who talks like a progressive. And if we can get 250,000 of them to turn out, then we will turn around the state of Georgia and we will be headed in the right direction. And that is why I'm running for governor. We have 29 days to go in Georgia. May 22nd is my primary. Woo! Thank you. And we have the momentum. I'm ahead in the polls, but about half of Georgians don't realize we have a primary yet, so we've got to start going on television and telling them. We are ahead on every issue. I've been endorsed by every major endorsement out there. The only one I didn't get, they didn't endorse me because I couldn't get my opponent to vote the right way. Yeah, it's as crazy as you think. But Labor has endorsed me. Planned Parenthood has endorsed me. Emily's List has endorsed me. Let America Vote has endorsed me. John Lewis has endorsed me. Every major endorsement has come my way because I've always stood on the right side of issues. When I was growing up in Mississippi, my dad worked at a place called Ingalls Shipbuilding. It's about 40 miles from where we grew up. And we only had one car, so my mom would have to keep the car to move the six of us around. But when my dad had to work more than one shift, he would call my mother to let her know that he was on his way home. But the problem was he would get a ride to work in the morning at 6 a.m. and get dropped off at 6 p.m. by a man named Mr. Luther. But on the days my dad had to work more than one shift, Mr. Luther was already at home, and so my father's only way to get home was to hitchhike down Highway 90 in Mississippi. My dad would call my mother at 8 p.m. or midnight or 2 a.m. and let her know that he was on his way, and my mom would start to pray. And I remember one winter night, my dad had been working multiple shifts all winter, and that night it was cold and it was raining and there had been storms and there had been accidents on the highway. And so when my dad called my mom to say, "Carolyn, I'm on my way," my mom got nervous. And so she came and woke us all up. And she said, "Stacy, I'm number two, my older sister Andrea." She told us to go wake up our younger siblings because we were gonna go look for my father. So we all piled in the car and we started driving down Highway 90 looking for my dad. My younger siblings asleep in the back. My older sister Andrea took one window, I took the other. And through the rain, Andrea saw my dad up ahead and my mom pulled off onto the shoulder so my dad could get in the car. But when he got in the car, he was wet, he was shivering. And my mother looked at him, she's like, "Robert, where is your coat? Did you leave it at the shipyard?" And my dad said, "No, I gave it to a homeless man on the beach." Now, Andrea and I looked at each other because we were waiting for the explosion. My mother was not known for her graciousness of us losing stuff. You lose a sock in our house, you need to have a ransom note. And yet, my dad has now given away his only coat. But to our surprise, my mom just looks at him and says, "Oh, okay." And she turns the car around and we go back down the highway. And they acted like that was normal. So Andrea looks at me and I look at her and I'm like, "You're older, you ask." And she leans forward and she says, "Daddy, why would you do that? Why would you give that man your coat? You don't have another one." And my dad turned around and he looked at us. He had the heat up high. And he said, "I gave that man my coat because when I came upon him on that beach, he was alone. And I knew when I left him there, he would still be alone. I could give him my coat because I knew you were coming for me. Chicago, I am coming for Georgia. Help me get there. Thank you so much." Thank you.
Of inspiration I think we all can use, and we're about to get some more of it. So if you haven't seen the new issue of Time Magazine, Time Magazine has named our next speaker Carmen Yulín Cruz, mayor of San Juan, one of the 100 most influential people in the world. In the world. Now, you know that last September, when Hurricane Maria destroyed most of the island of Puerto Rico, killing more than 1,000 people, maybe the mayor can update us on that. These are our fellow U.S. citizens, I remind you. There was one passionate and articulate voice that penetrated the unforgivable failure of the Trump administration and galvanize the world. So at that time, and you're gonna see it in a clip, the acting director of Homeland Security publicly called the recovery a good news story. So I want you to watch the screen and hear what a frustrated but resolute Mayor Cruz had to say about that.
Identified I know it's a hard storm to recover from, but the amount of progress that's been made, and I really would appreciate any support that we get. I know it is really a good news story in terms of our ability to reach people and the limited number of deaths that have taken place in such a devastating hurricane.
Ed Mayor.
Well, maybe from where she's standing, it's a good news story. When you're drinking from a creek, it's not a good news story. When you don't have food for a baby, it's not a good news story. When you have to pull people down from their buildings, because, you know, that, I'm sorry, but that really upsets me and frustrates me. You know, I would ask her to come down here and visit the towns and then make a statement like that, which frankly, it is an irresponsible statement, and it contrasts with the statements of support that I have been getting since yesterday when I got that call from the White House. This is not a good news story. This is a people are dying story. This is a life or death story.
Mayor Carmen Yulín Cruz, our hero.
There's a lot of nasty women in the house today. You know what nasty means? Nasty is what a bully calls a woman that can get shit done. I am the great-granddaughter of a sugarcane plantation worker that earned 50 cents a week for cutting sugarcane from 12 to 12. He spent many years telling her daughter, my grandmother, that education was a great equalizer, that she had to study, that she had to move on, that she had to do better for herself. So my grandmother did exactly that. She went to school. She got scholarships to go to NYU and Columbia University. And she became the first one in her family to learn how to read or write. She worked at a cafeteria at night so my father could eat in that cafeteria during the day. But she did something for me. She shielded me from poverty all her life. My parents mortgaged their home twice so that I could go to Boston University and then Carnegie Mellon University. They wanted me to have a better life, and they knew education was the way to do it. But my grandmother always taught me one thing, is that there's a choice you have to make in life when you see injustice. She also did it, and the people that are Latin here or Hispanic or Mexican will know, con la chancleta. You know? That just means she would have her shoe, and somehow she could boom around that thing all the way around the room, hit you, and it'll get back to her, right? So she told me, look, Yulín, which is what they call me. Nobody calls me mayor, they call me Yulín. I'm small, that's okay, Jen. You know, good things come in small sizes. We're fun size. And I was smaller, so she said, you know, you have to study a little harder, you have to run a little faster, you have to hit a little harder, and you have to scream at the top of your lungs when you see something that's not fair. Don't ever start a fight that you don't think it's worth fighting. And she said that to me. Well, on September 20th, we started a fight that has not yet finished. And actually, the world thinks of September 20th, but we actually had Irma during the same month of September. So it was 1-2 punch. And there was full darkness, total darkness, in the entire island nation of Puerto Rico. Still to this day, about 75,000 people do not have any electricity or running water. Now, we don't want that to live a life of luxury. We want it to be able to thrive and not survive. So what did we expect when everything was dark, we expected a commander-in-chief that would do his job. Now, we knew that, you know, he has his failings. We've seen him. We had all seen him. But we thought, no, surely, in a humanitarian crisis, this man will get his act together and do what he's supposed to do. Well, rather than being a commander-in-chief, he was a hater-in-chief. He tweeted his hate away day in and day out. And when I went to meet him on October 3rd, because he is the president of the United States and you have to respect the office if the man is not respectable, I stood there and he surely didn't want to shake my hand. And I said, Mr. President, this isn't about politics. It's about saving lives. But you see, he doesn't get it. It's not that he can't get it, it's that he doesn't want to get it. He doesn't want to know that we're all the same. He didn't want to know that we were suffering. So he started tweeting his hate away. Now, someone should take that damn Twitter account away from him. I guarantee you they will win the Nobel Peace Prize if they do that. And rather than going there and being supportive, he went down to Puerto Rico and threw paper towels at us. He insulted us. So my mother and father always told me, you have a choice. You have to stand up or you stand down. And if you stand up, you do it with every bit of your soul. If you stand out, you're an accomplice to injustice and intolerance. So I stood up, and I did what my grandmother taught me. I ran a little faster. I screamed a little louder, because while he was playing golf at Mar-a-Lago, we were dying. And there are people that are still dying. We still don't know how many people have actually died. It is estimated that about 1,500, more than 1,000 certainly have died, because the basic needs weren't there. And he violated our human rights, and he violated our civil rights. And he did it with the aid of a Congress that needs to get a grip on what reality is all about. So come November, you gotta pull the carpet from underneath Donald Trump. It's a moral imperative. It's not a should we, it's a how does it get done. It's not a when. You have the date, you have the mission, you have to move forward. So Mr. Trump didn't do what he was supposed to do. Because just because you live on 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue does not make you a good and decent man. In fact, this is a tenant that is not a good and decent man. Martin Luther King said, "Nothing in the world is more dangerous than sincere ignorance and conscientious stupidity." It was true then for Dr. King, and it is true now for all of us. For you see, indeed, we are an island surrounded by water, lots and lots of water, ocean water. That is an actual quote from the President of the United States. So a more profound question has to be answered. It isn't just a legal obligation, because since 1917, we're citizens of the United States, there is a moral obligation, one that a law cannot force you. And the American people took on that obligation. And you know, hey, we're here raising money because it's important to have money to get the message out. But having money is not a bad thing. It is what you do with that money and how you make it that it is a bad thing. Somewhere in December, a man that I didn't know called my office and said that he wanted to fly down with his family to meet me. And I said, oh, Lord, again. But then he said, well, you know, he's going to bring a donation for the foundation. And I said, okay, I'm dressed. And he's right here. I know I call you JB, and he's gone. I ruined his last name. But he went and did what other people in the government didn't do. They turned their back on us. It was like our lives didn't matter. It was like we were expendable. It was like, who cares if those colored people in the Caribbean of Hispanic heritage die? Well, the American people care. And I have to say, the Democratic Party cared. And people that I didn't know, I started getting dollar bills attached to a little piece of paper, one from a kid in Ohio, from teachers in Houston, from Wichita, places where I had never heard in the United States. Because humans know when humans are in need. That should explain why President Trump can't figure it out. But you see, it's much more than what has happened. Still, 500,000 homes in Puerto Rico are totally shattered or in need of having their roofs being put back together. 500,000 Puerto Ricans have moved into the United States after last November. But we have to ensure that we own up as Puerto Ricans what we have done wrong. We took too much money on loans that we couldn't pay. So time's up, we gotta pay the fiddler. But that doesn't mean, and I loved it, Stacey, what you said, that not having the means is something that will leave you on the side of the road. Now you see, sometimes they say that politics shouldn't be personal. And this is a room full of powerful women, but you know how they tell us. They tell us you can't show your emotions on TV. It'll make you look weak. Well, it makes us look weak when we cannot identify with pain and suffering. So you see, before I had seen poverty in my mind, I had never seen poverty in my heart. And of course, I'm the mayor of San Juan. I've seen the poor places, the poor communities. And they have a voice. We don't need to give them a voice. They have a voice. We just need to magnify that voice. That's why I'm so thankful for Jan Schakowsky for two things. One, for giving me the opportunity to speak before you. And two, because she gave me this handkerchief in Baltimore a few weeks ago. It was clean when she gave it to me. Because you see, I started to relate what I'm gonna tell you. And September 20th changed our lives. We will never be the same. We will never be the same. I've seen mothers just hold on to a rope to go to the other side for their children to get nebulizers, or they would die from an asthma attack. I've seen people that haven't had their chemotherapy or their dialysis for 3 weeks with their eyes glazed, who could still smile when we went to pick them up. I've seen women putting up soup kitchens all over San Juan and Puerto Rico to ensure that those who did not have could have something to eat. This is real, and it's still going on today. So you see, we need friends in good places. We need friends in the Congress of the United States, like Jan, but so many others, because it is our friends that truly embody the values of the American people. What is this president telling us? That life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness only pertains to if you are what he thinks America should be? No. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness pertains to every human, whether you're a citizen of the United States or you are not. So you gotta put dreamers. Dreamers have to be part of that conversation, and for that to happen, you have to win. There is no option. Second place is not an option. You have to win. So you have to be able to put health before wealth. And for that to happen, say it with me. You have to
win.
Oh, come on, you're not gonna win with that. And you know, for people of color, have to be willing to walk and show the pride in who we are. And he said, well, she looks white. Well, you know, I'm Hispanic, orgullosa de serlo. So if that makes me a person of color, that's it. But you see, the fight is the same in Puerto Rico for survival and in here. So why would a man, a young kid, a black kid in the suburbs get 20 times he was shot for having a cell phone? But a white kid that killed 17 people in Parkland is safely removed from the street. Shouldn't they both have the same right? Shouldn't they both be treated with the same respect? So you see, calling Puerto Rico a territory, it's legally true, but it's a euphemism for colony. That is what it is. It's a euphemism for colony. So we need friends in the right places in order to put together a process that is democratic, that really embodies the values of the American people, that will let the Puerto Rican people decide what a future of dignity and commonality could look like. That is what we need. Jan, I don't know if this is the right way of saying it, and Stacey sort of said it in a way, but beware. Beware of people that call themselves Democrats and act from pages, tearing up pages of the Republican handbook. Because putting vouchers in schools is not a democratic value. Schools be charters or selling them is not a democratic value. For you see, when we start, en español se dice aguando. I don't know how do you say, how do you say that in English? Aguando. ¿Cómo? Watering down, yes. When you start watering down the values that bring you together, then what are you? Then what are we? So, yes, we have to stand together. That's why I was so honored, and I know he's here, when Bob Picard and the DuPage Democratic people asked me last Saturday to be amongst them. It was a great honor. Because what is happening in Puerto Rico is a metaphor for what you have suffered ever since Donald Trump became president of the United States. This is about saving lives. June 1st, the next hurricane season begins. And you would think that that $4.9 billion that was given to Puerto Rico as a loan, late November, beginning of December, would have already gotten there. No, not one cent. Not one cent. Because the Trump administration wants the Puerto Rican people to use that money to pay the hedge funds. Now that is where his priorities are, and it's not in saving lives. I saw a young boy, 6 to 7 months old, grab on to a bottle of water as his life depended on it, because his life depended on it. And when I called for help and said, somebody help us, the American people answer the call. Our union brothers and sisters answer the call. ...320 AFL-CIO workers left their homes and went down to Puerto Rico to help teachers, machinists, plumbers, electricians. So Jan, you've given this fight for many years and there's still a lot of fight left in you. I am proud to stand with you. Because when it mattered, you told us our lives mattered. And I'll finish with two things. Jan had the courage to vote against the Fiscal Control Board, alongside Luis Gutierrez and others, that understood that imposing a dictatorship of seven in a democratic society is taking democracy away. So you see, there are seven people now that make decisions. Now, I don't see eye to eye with the governor of Puerto Rico. He's the one, by the way, who's doing the charters and the vouchers and the selling of the schools. But he was democratically elected, and I have to respect that process. So seven people are the ones that decide, and now they've decided to lower pensions for the elderly. They've decided to raise the tuition in the university from $55 a credit to $157 a credit. They've decided that from the 10 campuses that the university has, five of them are going to be obliterated. So they're taking our chance to have an educated youth. They've decided that they're going to pay more to the hedge funds that they're going to provide in medication to our people. They're lowering health care to a basic standard, and then people have to opt up, pay, to get the same level of services that they are getting today. That is out of the Republican playbook. Austerity measures do not work. You know it, we know it. So when it was time to say and do the political thing, Jan did what her conscience told her to do. Taking away democracy is not the way to foster it. If it helps in any way, shape, or form, count me in, because 27 million Latinos did not vote on the last election. 27 million Latinos did not vote. So we have to make sure that Latinos understand that they need to get on the ballot. So yes, you have to give your money, you have to repeat the message, but you have to what? Vote. You have to vote, because if you don't vote, none of this will be enough. I'll end up with this. People died, and it wasn't the ones that I got to that stay with me. It's the ones that I know that I didn't get to. It's the ones that I know that died alone because they didn't have enough money to put diesel in a generator to keep their life-saving equipment functioning. It's the women that knew that their children wouldn't make it. It's the voices of the elderly people screaming from buildings, Yulín, ayúdame, help me. People died and are dying. So this isn't about partisan politics. It's about people. But the truth is that there is a party in this country that puts people ahead of anything else. So you owe it to the world to take the power away from President Trump and turn the Congress into a life-saving machine rather than a powerhouse for those that want more. The fight is amongst us. And my grandmother told me never to start a fight, but she also told me never, never to leave one unfinished. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
They're standing for you. They're standing for Stacey. We're standing because we have to win. Thank you so much for being here today.